Good evening. We'll go ahead and get started tonight. Renee, please show all board members present. So if you will join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Bork, as I understand, you're taking us through board salutes tonight.
Yes, I am. Ms. Wesley cannot attend the meeting this evening, so we're going to postpone her recognition until January. And I'm going to go a little out of order. We're going to start with a recognition with the Clark Memorial Hospital Foundation. In the fall of 2014, Greater Clark County Schools collaborated with Clark Memorial Hospital and Clark Physician Group to open student health clinics to provide limited healthcare services to students. The student clinics are operated at Charlestown High School and Jeffersonville High School and accessible to all Greater Clark students. A nurse practitioner is available when school is in session to treat students for minor illnesses in an effort to decrease student absences and increase student achievement. The district is pleased to announce that the Clark Memorial Hospital Foundation has donated $150,000 to help the operating cost of these clinics. The board salutes the Clark Memorial Foundation. Please come forward, representatives. Present this evening, Clark Memorial Hospital CEO Martin Padgett and former Clark Memorial Hospital Foundation Chairman Jay Connor for their generous contribution, which directly benefits the health and wellness of our students.
For our students and our families. You know, 34% of our families have no primary care provider. And so it is, in many cases, the only opportunity that these students and families have to get high quality health care. And when we thought about this idea, we contacted Martin. Martin was very open to the idea. Now, he had his hands full because he had some other things on his plate at that time too. But you know what, he's always made time for our school system. And when we were able to partner and bring in nurse practitioners of very high quality, absolutely no complaints from anybody, the level of service, the level of care has been second to none. And so for your partnership to our school corporation and for your generosity through the foundation, and Jay, as a representative of the board, we made a presentation. Your board is extremely generous, and for $150,000, that will really go a long way to maintaining strong and stable health care for our kids in our district. So, again, thank you so much for everything you've done for our students and for our school corporation. Thank you.
Coordinator of ELL, Kelly Dier. She's actually going to present our next recognition. Good evening. The board salutes Mayera Martins Pereira, a Jeffersonville High School 12th grade exchange student from Brazil, and she will be featured on the cover of the Indiana Teachers of English to Speakers of Other Languages journal. Mayera's artwork has been selected as the 2015 NTESOL Student Art Contest winner. This is a statewide competition for ELL K through 12 students. And congratulations, Mayera.
Community citizens like we just did that are so beneficial to our corporation. teachers and or administrators or staff members and all our students. We can't tell you how proud of you we are. We're glad that you've made the decision to come to our community and to come to our school, and for you to get this recognition. We're just very, very proud of you, and thank you for everything that you do for our school system. Absolutely.
Want to move into the remainder of the meeting. So next item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Any changes tonight?
So moved.
All right, thank you, Mr. Hall.
Second.
Mr. White, sorry. All right.
Only other guy down
here. I know. All right, all in favor? Be 7-0, thank you. All right, next is the approval of the minutes from previous meetings. We have executive, regular, and special. I'd like to take all those together.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft and Ms. Gilkey. Second, thank you. All right, all in favor? 7-0, thank you. Dr. Millen, any public comments on agenda items tonight?
No, sir, not tonight.
Okay. Next is the consent agenda. We have six items tonight, and I'd like to take those together.
Move to approve.
Thank you, Mr. White.
Second.
And thank you, Ms. Solman. Any questions, comments? All right. All in favor? Be 7-0. Thank you. Ms. Kraft, would you do the honor of gifts to buildings?
Trying to get my thing here. Yes. It's just an amazing amount of money. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, $33,000 is almost unbelievable. We have so many people to thank for so much faith in what we do, and it's just very, very much appreciated. And I'm honored to make the motion that we accept the gifts to buildings.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Kraft.
Second.
And thank you, Ms. Perkins. All in favor? Be 7-0. Thank you. Moving into action items, the first one is the Pleasant Ridge Library naming rights. And Dr. Hartledge. Good evening.
Good evening. I see lots of familiar faces here tonight. Welcome all of you teachers who are joining us. And I stand here tonight. I'm very honored. We have such a wonderful community in Greater Clark County Schools. And we lost a wonderful member of that family this fall. Shelley Blake, those of you who knew her, you don't ever forget her. One of our parents, Mrs. Porter, our principal, one of our principals had submitted several letters in support of naming the library after Miss Blake. She made every person that she came in contact with and student feel like they were the most important person in the world. And those little kiddos that she had the opportunity to work with, she has touched their lives in a way that they will absolutely never forget. And I think I can also extend that to every staff member, every teacher, every administrator that she's come in contact with. So we have submitted these documents to outline the dedication and influence that she has had, not only on our students, but on our entire school district community and the extended community. Her passion and enthusiasm was for the love of reading, and she wanted every child to always have a book to read. She prided herself on having the most elaborate classroom library in the building. So tonight, we would like to ask that we name the library at Pleasant Ridge in her honor for Ms. Shelley Blake. And I'd like to ask the Pleasant Ridge staff here tonight to go ahead and stand because they certainly have had a wonderful community closeness and come together in this time of tragedy to celebrate the joy and gifts that she brought to all of us. So thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Hartledge.
As a personal friend of hers, I would be more than happy to make that motion.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft.
And I would be honored to second that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Comments, Questions? All in favor? Be 7-0. Thank you.
But, Mr. Pave, we have a video
That
we would like to show in tribute to Ms. Blake. And we have a lot of great teachers in this school corporation, a lot of great staff members. Just in the short time that I've been here, I cannot tell you how encouraging she always was to me as the superintendent. You know, she always cared about how I was doing and how I was feeling, which meant a lot. So this is a tribute to her.
Thank you.
thank you for coming tonight and show of support of Shelley. Words cannot explain, so thank you. All right, next item on the agenda is the addendum to the Commerce Bank agreement. Dr. Dykel?
Yes, a couple years ago, we entered into an agreement with Commerce Bank from Indianapolis to pay our bills via Visa to a Visa program from our vendors who accept Visa and thereby earning 1.1% cash back. We're trying everything we can to get extra money coming into the school district. Commerce Bank has informed us of two programs that they have that they could help increase our revenue share. One program was manual AP, where Commerce would make payments to those vendors who accept credit cards on their website. The other program was our private network. This is where Commerce would process a credit card transaction for the vendor at a reduced rate. For both of these programs, we need a modification to our current agreement signed by the board. Attached is the modification agreement. The agreement was reviewed by Mrs. Lewis, our general counsel. We're asking board permission to enter into this agreement, see if we can try to get some more 1.1% cash back. We're on our way to another $60,000 a year. Mm-hmm. So it's working pretty good. I'd like to see 70.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Dykel.
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. Second. Thank you, Ms. Zolman. Any questions, comments for Dr. Dykel? All in favor? B70. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is the resolution and interlocal agreement and commissioners of Clark County for salt and brine. Ms. Lewis.
Thank you and good evening.
Good evening.
Excuse me. We have been working with the Clark County commissioners since 2010 on a location to receive our supply of salt and brine when we experience bad weather. Now, let's all knock on a little wood and hope that we don't have to use that. But last year, we exhausted 130 tons of salt, and we pay for the brine on an as-needed basis. So we are, again this year, working with the county commissioners for a supply, a guaranteed supply. We need to make sure we have a location that we can go to get salt and brine on an as-needed basis. But we do want to go ahead and purchase and prepay for 130 tons of salt at $76.50 per ton, and that will be a cost of $9,945. When we use the brine, we only pay for that on an as-needed basis. But this gives us the opportunity to stockpile 130 tons, and that's what we have, over the past few years, we've tried to add to our stockpile to get us to maintain initially 130 tons. So the recommendation this evening from the superintendent is to approve the resolution and the interlocal agreement with the commissioners of Clark County so that we can have that 130 tons of salt on hand, and so that we do know we have a location for brine on an as-needed basis.
All right, thank you, Ms. Lewis. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. Thank you, Ms. Gilkey. Questions, comments for Ms. Lewis on salt and brine? All right, all in favor? B70, thank you.
Thank you.
Next is the Jeffersonville High School radio TV naming. And Dr. Mellon?
Board, it is an honor for me this evening to bring forward for your consideration the naming of the new radio and television facility at Jeffersonville High School after Teddy Throckmorton. Teddy Throckmorton has been a lifelong resident of the city of Jeff, has been a community servant for the city of Jeff. He was maybe one of the most avid supporters of the Jeff High basketball program for his whole life, and broadcast Jeffersonville athletic events for 40 years. And I cannot think of a better honor than to name the new radio and TV studio at Jeff High after Teddy Throckmorton. His son was not able to be here this evening. It would be our intent to, once the facility is up and running, fully operational, that we would have a dedication evening to honor, but in the studio, it'll be named Throckmorton Studios. The ID that's given at the top of every hour would mention Throckmorton Studios. So it's to me, a great way for our community to recognize someone that has been such a great supporter of Jeffersonville High School for so many years. And so it'd be an honor for me to bring that forward to you as a recommendation that we name the radio TV facility at Jeff High after Teddy Throckmorton.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Mellon.
Honored to make that recommendation.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins.
Second.
Thank you. Mr. White, any questions, comments for Dr. Mellon? All in favor? B7-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Mellon, I think you're going to take us through the facility plan, or is that Dr. Hare?
We're going to tag team.
Tag team tonight. Okay.
Board, just to give you an overview, obviously, many people worked very hard over a long period of time looking at the referendum that came before voters on November 3rd. And obviously, that result was very disappointing. But that's also what makes our country great, is that it has the opportunity for people to express their opinion on things. So, but we need to move forward. And the reality is that we have a lot of issues with a lot of our buildings, as identified not only through the Covert-Hawkins study, but also through a roofing study that was completed some time ago, and then also in talking to our building principals. So what we have done is I've asked Dr. Hare, who one of his main responsibilities is our facilities, along with Dr. Deichel, to review all of that information and put together a five-year plan, and that's what will be presented to you here in just a minute. But the five-year plan was based upon the fact that what needs to be done within the next 3 to 5 years to all of our buildings that either would be paid for through capital projects dollars, and we have about $2 million a year available to maintain our facilities, or through bond issues that would be, again, per statute, no more than $2 million. So everything that we've presented, and I'll have Dr. Harris sort of go through this, but it's all with that in mind, that we have issues with our facilities. This is a plan that we want to present to you tonight, not necessarily for your action, but to give you a chance to process through it. It would be our goal that every year we'd bring this five-year plan to you, because each year priorities may change, the amount of dollars available may change, the tax implications may change, and so every year we'll bring it to you for your consideration and approval, so people know what we're trying to get accomplished in terms of maintaining quality facilities in our school system. So maybe at that point I'll turn it over to Dr. Hare and then come back to you later.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Mellon. First thing that you'll notice on the summary page board is that one of the things we wanted to do was touch every building within the next 2 years. So you'll see that right off the bat off of those first two columns. So we've got two columns, 16, 17, and then the third column would be for the next 3 years, 18, 19, and 20. So that's an overview. You can see that it's 13.3 million in 16, 19.2 in 17, and then 32.5 over the next 3 years. And board, just to let you know, a big portion of that 3 to 5 year has to do with geothermal, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. It's some of the cost savings that Dr. Deichel would want to, that wants to talk about. Let's start with Bridgepoint. And you'll see there, I've broken each school down. We can go through the elementaries first, and then we'll hit the middles, and then the high schools. And each school is broken down with the 3 years. Some of this, a lot of this comes from the Covert-Hawkins study, the things that they recommended. As Dr. Mellon mentioned, we also had a roofing study that was done. One of the things from Bridgepoint, one of the first things you'll notice is a roof. Half of that roof has already been done, but the other half has not been touched for several years, so that still needs to be done. And then we asked all of the building principals for input, so that's how we came up with this list. And then there's still work to be done as to what would be bonded and what would come out of CPF. Certainly you'll see on this one, cafeteria tables, that is probably something that come out of CPF, maybe not the bond. So that is still the work that we have to do. And then the other thing before we move forward is, board, you'll see in one of the things that we've talked about is you'll see a lot of this has to do with roofs. It has to do with HVAC, whether it be heating and air, and then security, and then there's athletics and the fine arts. So you'll see that there's a common theme that runs through a lot of these. So that would be Bridgepoint. Jonathan Jennings, that was one of the schools with the referendum. There's a $500,000 there. And again, you'll see that is just really roofs, HVAC work, some security, and a little bit of work in the cafeteria. Maple Elementary, again, boilers need to be replaced. There's some rooftop units that need some work, and then the controls need to be looked at, and that would be a project that would go possibility in 2017. So that would be Maple. New Washington, the air conditioning, the gym, that came out of the Covert-Hawkins study. There's about $340,000 to do there in 17, and then you'll see some ongoing work. There's some playground, and that's not putting in the playground. Typically, PTOs will buy elementary schools their playground. There's actually some site work that needs to be done back there with some drainage. I was aware of the drainage in the back, but not the front. So we'll take a look at that. North Haven, that was one of the things with the referendum that we talked about, to eliminate the open concept, something that really needs to be done. Board, we put $2 million. That's something that is going to be by far greater than $2 million, but something that we'll have to piecemeal as we go along over the next several years to improve the safety piece of that, so that we will present North Haven there. Parkwood was one of the schools for the referendum, and you can see there's going to be some ongoing work there. Parkwood is at capacity. It's busting at the seams. You'll see in 16 a roof, and then there's an open concept area that needs to be addressed. We did put in for 2017 possibly portables. The need for possibly two portables as a Band-Aid solution. They're about $50,000 each. And then if we need to add on additional classrooms, that would buy some time to see where the enrollment's going. So again, this is a plan, it's a possibility, but it's something that we probably need to consider as we look down the road. Pleasant Ridge, clearly a school that needs some attention. We want to, there's some Head Start, some playground in 16, and again, that's probably something that could come out of CPF relatively easily. And then 2017, you'll see there are some major renovations that need to occur there at PR, and I'm not saying anything that they don't already know. So we'll take care of that. Riverside, there again, these are chairs and the cafeteria. This would be something that would probably come out of CPF. You could tell that is something that the building has asked for. Spring Hill, again, some HVAC, the rooftop units, new boilers, windows for energy efficiency, and then there's still a roof that needs to be done at Spring Hill, and looking at that in 2017 as we bring that back and study 2016 to see what we will do with the elementary schools. That is there. Thomas Jefferson, some substantial work that needs to be done there. I think that's our oldest building in the corporation, and you'll see that's some work that would need to be done in 17 and then over the next 3 years as a possibility. So we've broken that down for you there. Utica is similar to PR, and it's going to need some work done there, the roofing and the walls. Really, we have some spots in both of those buildings, new construction, but we're constructed the same way, and we've got some really severe leaks in both of those schools that we would need to address. Wilson, take a look at that. Again, pretty much a dated building, but putting some funds into it in 17, and then some ongoing in 18 to the next 3 years. The roofing is going to need to be done there, and that's a pretty substantial cost there at Wilson. Charlestown Middle School, one of the referendum schools to eliminate the open concept, was something that we discussed during the referendum time. It's something that we'll need to get on right away. And again, just like North Haven, we'll have to do that over a series of years. And there's some stuff on there as well. The geothermal retrofit, you'll see that for the first time. It's about a $5 million. It is expenses up front, but it can be very energy efficient. And that would be something that we would study over the next several years. Again, this is a plan. This is a possibility, things that we need to make sure we keep on our radar. Parkview Middle School would be minimal in 16, and then some upgrades in 17. Their auditorium is in need of a remodeling to upgrade the gym. The cafeteria needs to be done. Again, you'll see some student desks that are on there. Those are things that we could possibly take care of CPF. There are two chillers that we need to replace. So again, HVAC and roofs, when you've got dated buildings, that's where a lot of this money will go. River Valley, as you remember, board, obviously the third school with the open concept would be something that we need to get on right away. Probably in a perfect world, we would like to start in 16 with $2 million, but there's a need there. That cooling tower needs to be replaced. It is pretty dated, and I think there are three or four boilers there, and we're only running on about half of them, two of them, I think. And there, you just can't find parts. Our guys are actually fabricating parts for us there on site. So it's something that is going to need immediate attention to be taken care of. Charlestown High School, you'll see there in 16, some land acquisition. That is some stuff that will need to be used for the athletics and to possibly move some of the practice fields. There's also some work in the auditorium that needs to be done. And then, believe it or not, you're going to say we just did a renovation. We did, but there was a portion of the roof that has been there since 1976 that hasn't been touched. That's going to need to be have some upgrading and some replacement on that. So you will see that as it carries through with Charlestown High School. Kind of a similar story at Jeffersonville High School. Some ongoing things, continuing with the radio TV, the auditorium. There's some security cameras there. The Marshall Building is something we've brought to you before. That needs to be wrapped up in 16 and then 17 and 18, just like at Charlestown. Start working on the athletic facilities as well. So that would take care of the high schools. Then concluding with New Washington, you'll see in 16 that we've got some mini buses that we need to purchase, and there are mini buses throughout this plan, really in need, dire need of upgrading our mini buses. There are some new bleachers that need to be installed at New Washington High School. There's some work there at the pool. And then some of the student lockers in the locker rooms, that's a major expense. And then down the road, if we wanted to put lights on the athletic fields, that would be certainly something on a wish list down the road. Court and Porter is one of our newer buildings. And you see that is basically just to reseal the parking lot. And then there are a couple of minibuses. They are constantly taking kids out in the community, borrowing buses and transportation. And this would give them some access to be able to take our students there. Clark County Middle High, again, is just HVAC that would need to be replaced a few years out. The administration building, you'll see the first is just to repair and stripe the parking lot. We would do Utica and all of that at the same time. There's no security system in this building, and we would want to discuss that. And then, again, that geothermal retrofit, if we were starting to do that in the buildings, we could discuss that and the cost savings here at the administration building. The service center is probably one of our buildings that is in the worst shape, and we have several different options that we would like to explore, but it is going to be something that we're going to need to tackle in 16, 17, and 18, and we just budgeted $2 million for each of those years to get that work completed as well. And then the old Cordon Porter, we use that for storage, and it's still one of our buildings. If we choose to continue to own it, we're going to need to be responsible for the upkeep, and it needs a new roof, and that's about a $50,000 outlay there. So that was relatively quick, board, but I know we'll be back in a couple weeks. Wanted to give you an opportunity to look at it, to digest it. That was kind of the first pass by school, and we certainly will entertain any questions. Dr. Mellon, I'll turn it back over to you.
Just real quickly, board, a few things as a point of emphasis. You know, these are priorities, so there's a lot more work that needs to be done, but looking at what needs to be done within the next 3 to 5 years, this is what the facility study pointed out to us, as well as just looking at other factors and issues. So and this list can change from year to year. I think the key factor is looking at what do we need to get accomplished in 16 and making sure that we look at that within 2 weeks so that we can plan accordingly. I also think that Maple Spring Hill, the conversation needs to continue with those two buildings. Not only are there issues as identified here with those buildings, but we have enrollment of less than 200 students in each building. And the enrollment continues to decrease there. And as much as we love those communities and those students and so on, it's not cost effective to keep two buildings open. So it's a discussion. A lot of different options that can be considered. So we're not making that judgment with this plan. What we are doing is saying, if we do work at those buildings, this is the work that needs to be done. And again, in 2016, I think we need to have discussion not only amongst you as a board and our administrative team, but also with community citizens and staff at those two buildings to talk about options moving forward. River Valley, Charlestown Middle, and North Haven, we have clearly said we need to move forward on those. Safety is a major concern. The people who teach in those buildings, I have great respect for. All you have to do is spend about 30 seconds in during instructional time to know how challenging it is to teach in that environment. We want kids to be engaged, and believe me, they are. But you can also hear kids being engaged in two or three or four other classrooms all around the place. So it may take a piecemeal approach, as Dr. Hare mentioned, where we do portions of those buildings each year in order to finally get it enclosed. But it, to me, our recommendation, and you can decide, you know, the direction, but we think that that has to maintain a top priority for us for safety and learning reasons. Referendum, I don't know what the future holds. November of 16, we've got a lot of work to do before we were to move forward on a referendum. And so November of 16, unless you instruct me otherwise, I would not recommend it. In 17, there are no elections. So the first time that we would come back on big projects would be 2018, and again, that would be subject to your authorization to make that happen. So right now, we have work to do, and we have to take care of our buildings, and we need to make sure they're safe and healthy for our staff and for our staff and for our community, for our kids. So that's just a broad overview in a relatively quick time frame, and I greatly appreciate Dr. Hare and Dr. Deichel for the work that they've done in putting this together.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Mellon. Comments from the board?
Dr. Mellon, you know, I believe something that goes hand in hand with this would be a report or a recommendation on how do we maintain our existing buildings right now. What do we do? I know we do a lot of painting in the summertime. We do a lot of landscaping, and I think that needs to go hand in hand with this, because it's, to me, we've had a history of we'll build something new, and then we let it, and we halfway maintain it until it falls apart, then we got to build new again. You know, I would like to see what is our plan to keep our existing buildings up to snuff, for lack of a better word, and if we do build something new, you know, what's our plan to maintain that with proper maintenance, custodial service, and I think that needs to be added.
We'll be happy to bring that kind of report forward. You know, board, we have about $7.5 million in our capital projects fund on an annual basis, but $4.5 to $5 million of that are already dedicated dollars. They're dedicated to technology staff, to skilled trades people. They're dedicated to insurance, utilities. So when it comes right down to it, we have about $2 to $2.5 million a year that we have to use to maintain our buildings. So for us to bring forward a report for you so that you can see how those dollars are being spent, we'll be happy to do that.
Another thing that I'd like to see is that during the referendum, there was a lot of discussion about taxpayer dollars and how they were being spent, and were we good stewards of those dollars? Mm-hmm. And I would like to see a comparison of per pupil cost per building. You know, mm-hmm. How much does it cost per pupil at Utica Elementary? How much does it cost per pupil at Spring Hill?
Right.
Including administrative, all of it, okay. All the costs.
Do that as well for you.
Thank you.
It's just hard to sit here and know that you've been defeated, which is what we have been.
It is.
That's tough for an Irish grandmother, let me tell you.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen often. Usually I can get by with cookies or something, get my way. Anyway, so we still have the same problems we had before, and we tried very hard to convince you that we had problems. So now we're going to try to do it a different way. It won't be as quick, and it probably won't be quite as good as we would like. But we think it's important to have good schools. If we're going to have new bridges, then we're going to influence more people to live in this great community, and it really is a good place to live. And we need the public to understand how good we are at what we do and how much we care about kids. And that's just not something that you say when you're running for election. That's what you do. Like, these are my favorite papers tonight. These are kindergarten papers, because I had the privilege of reading, and then I get the privilege of reading thank you notes that are really pretty good, actually. The printing's not too bad. But that's my take. It's just a sad day for us, but we're going to go on. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft, for your comments.
Board, just to carry forward on that a little bit, you know, we're going to continue to lobby the superintendents in this area. We're all in the same boat. We all have facilities that are in need of major work. And so across the state, more of these are winning now than losing, these referendums. But the reality is the legislature puts schools in an unfair position in many ways. We can talk about ISTEP, which we have in the past, and school accountability grades, which is flawed and needs major reform. But from a facility perspective, there's no other governmental entity that has to go through this process and go out in front of voters and put our name on the line and put people in positions to decide on how they're going to support children in schools or are they concerned about their taxes. There is no other governmental entity in this state that has to go through that process. Why should K-12 public schools be put in that position? Why does a DLGF on the referendum, why must we only put the maximum rate, which was 39 cents, when the real rate was 19? The DLGF would confirm that if you ask them the question. But on the referendum, it had to be 39. So it makes it look like we're misleading the public. There needs to be serious reform in this state in regard to the referendum process. It's unfair, and communities are dealing with it all over the state. So you know what we're going to do? We're going to continue to fight the fight, because our kids and our staff and our community deserve it. And it's my hope that with your backing and support and the support of others in this room and all over our district, we'll start sending the message loud and clear that our kids and our staff and our community deserve better. We should not be second class in terms of our facilities. We deserve to not have Taj Mahals, but good quality facilities. We deserve it. And one way or the other, we're going to work to make it happen. And right now, this plan that was presented by Dr. Hare is a starting point to at least say, you know what, we're going to do what we can, we're going to control what we can to make things right. So I better stop talking.
I thought you were doing a great job. So.
Yeah. I just want to say one thing. I greatly appreciate the work that you all put into the plan. Going back to the facility study that Covert Hawkins did, speaking with our building leaders to see what they truly make a priority in their own buildings. Jared called me the night after the referendum was defeated, and he asked me what we were going to do. And I said, well, honestly, I don't know, but I can tell you one thing we're not going to do, and that's give up. And so this is just the next step. This is our contingency plan. This is what we have to do, and I appreciate the work that you all put into it. I personally can tell you, being a product of Charlestown Middle School, that those middle schools and North Haven is a priority for me personally. We've got to make those learning opportunities better for our students, and we have to make the building safer for our staff and our students. So personally, you know, that's my priority. I'm only one board member, but I think those are the three things we need to get started on right away.
Well, to say that we were disappointed, I think, would be an understatement. I think we all had high hopes that we were going to be able to get this done. We didn't. It's not good for students, but as Dr. Mellon said, we're going to regroup and we're going to move on. As I said earlier, this is a hill worth dying on, and I think Dr. Mellon said that we're not going to be able to do it in 16, we're not going to be able to do it in 17, probably not till 18. So, but I think we are going to be able to wear some legislators out. I mean, I plan on doing that. And, you know, hopefully we can get this disaster turned around and put our kids in buildings that they deserve. So, anyway. But thanks for all of your work on the facility plan. I know you had to regroup pretty quickly, put together something to keep us from thinking we're not flying blind. And this is a good priority list. I know you'd said that we'll probably be working on tweaking this. And it's sort of a straw man at this point, but a lot of hard work. And so appreciate what your cabinet did, what you've done, and look forward to moving through.
Thank you. Thank you.
So. All right. Any requests for board reports or requests tonight? No? Next is public comments.
Sorry. I thought we were going around the table. I apologize. Just a quick report. Ms. Zolman, myself, and Dr. Mellon, last Friday, I had an opportunity to meet with some of our local legislators, and we had some very frank discussion regarding referendum process, legislation, TIF money, and I just want you all to know we're pretty blessed in this area that we actually get to have those conversations with our legislators. Steve Stimler is amazing to always show up and listen. Ron Grooms always shows up and listens. And even though he's not our direct rep, we meet as a group, New Omni Floyd, Wes Clark, and so Ed Clare also is very habitual in coming to those meetings and listening to us. And as far as the ISBA, the state board, is concerned, we now have a grassroots movement that's working its way through the rest of the state where other boards are going to come together to start having these conversations with the local legislators. And we feel like that's the best way to start getting things done. So I just wanted to let you all know that we had met with them. We had some really good conversation. We're going to be coming back to the table again in December, I believe.
January.
Sometime before they actually go to session, because you know they have a pretty weird time frame, and we want to make sure and get in their ear again before they start making decisions. So I wanted to let you all know that. And then also this Friday, I'll be traveling up to Indianapolis for our quarterly Indiana School Board Directors meeting. So I'll bring back information to you all from that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gilkey. Anyone else? I'm sorry, I should have went on. Down the table, I guess. Mm-hmm. All right. Next item is public comments on non-agenda items. I believe we have two tonight. Mr. Zukas, is he here tonight? Okay. Mr. McLaughlin. Good evening.
Members of the board, administration, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I want to say it's humbling to follow what you did with Ms. Blake and the naming of the library and all you folks here that are in support of that. That she is the epitome of a teacher and what we would expect for anyone to be. I'm here to speak about the payday schedule for the coming year. The original schedule called for paychecks to be issued every 2 weeks for the 15-16 year through July 29th, 2016. The paydays for the 16-17 year were then to begin August 12th and pay every 2 weeks through the end of 16 and on into 17. Apparently, paying on that schedule results in 27 paydays in the 16 calendar year, which according to our corporate accounting staff, either is it cannot or is unable to be budgeted. To address the 27 payday complication, it was proposed that the payday calendar be amended so that during the summer of 16, there be two consecutive three-week periods as opposed to two-week periods between paydays, and that the start of the 16-17 paydays begin on August 26th, a full 5 weeks after the start of the work year. We believe this creates an unacceptable burden on the employees of the corporation, in essence, going 6 weeks with one paycheck. While some might not see the difficulty in this, those that have automatic payment withdrawals, those who budget on a cash basis, those who live paycheck to paycheck which I dare say is a significant number of our employees, this is extremely burdensome, if only for the simple fact that redoing a budget at this point is very complicated. We've met with the county personnel and the deputy superintendent and proposed a change. We have suggested that the 15-16 paydays continue as originally scheduled, ending on July 29, 2016, and that there be 1 3-week window between the last pay for the 15-16 year and the first payday for the 16-17 year, making the first payday for that year August 19th, which also lessens the time between the start of the year for new employees from 5 weeks to 4 weeks for their first payday. We believe that this schedule would push the need for this to ever happen again back to at least the year 2020. We've been advised that while this might work for teachers and other groups that are less than year-round employees, there is still some complicating factor for year-round employees. While we really believe in our proposal, we are more than willing to listen to other ways to prevent your employees from going 2 consecutive 3-week periods without a paycheck. The essential point is this: 2 consecutive 3 weeks without a paycheck is unconscionable. We believe the administration is looking for a solution. However, we want to stress that there needs to be some solution to 2 back-to-back 3-week periods without a paycheck, or with 1 paycheck. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McLaughlin. We'll certainly take that under advisement and be talking to the administration about it. And we appreciate you bringing the facts to us. All right, next we have board comments. Mr. White?
I have nothing, thank you.
All right. Ms. Perkins?
No, thank you.
Ms. Ullman?
I'm just glad to see so many people here. Sometimes I feel like we don't have many people here for our board meetings, and I appreciate that. And I also want to send blessings to Pleasant Ridge. You've done a wonderful job of taking care of Shelley, and I appreciate that.
Ms. Kraft?
I think I've said enough already.
No, thank you.
Mr. Hall? Ms. Gilkey?
No, thank you.
Nothing for me. Dr. Mellon?
I'm good, thank you.
All right. Adjournment. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins.
Second.
And thank you, Ms. Gilkey. All in favor? Good night.